So I should have the U version on there. If not, then that is my fault. No one else's. So if you guys do have that, if you want to open those up, because I do have some different phrases in there that will be really helpful for you guys as I preach through tonight. First question to start off, question of the day, what is the falling action of a story? Do we have any English? The falling action of a story? Go ahead and raise your hand. Yes, Morgan. The what? Yes, okay. Sorry, I didn't know if that was Latin or not. Sorry, yes. It is the part of the story after the climax that follows the climax. What happens in the falling action is a direct consequence or effect from the climax. So if you guys think about like a movie, let's say Star Wars A New Hope, the falling action would be the part where they all go to that ceremony and they all get rewarded after they blew up the Death Star. Sorry. That was like 50 years ago. Like, but the part of the ceremony is a direct result, a direct consequence of them blowing up the Death Star, right? That is the falling action part of the story. So one of the examples I'm going to bring up is, has anyone ever seen the greatest war movie of all time, Saving Private Ryan? Yes. It's a fantastic movie, right? Well, does anyone know that what's different about Saving Private Ryan from most movie or story structures? Anybody know? Maybe not. Okay. What's that? Yes. The climax of the war is actually in the beginning of the movie when they storm D-Day, right? They go up on Omaha Beach, Tom Hanks and his whole army of brothers next to him, they go up and they storm the beach. And then after that, they secure a place in Normandy, France, so that way they can invade France and then eventually invade Berlin. So the story follows after that. Interesting enough, the story takes place in the falling action of World War II. Right? And so if you remember the story, if you haven't, I'm sorry, but hopefully you'll get to see it sometime. But basically, they storm into France, right? And they're after trying to save this man, his name's Saving Private Ryan, yours truly, Matt Damon. And they go in, and they find him, but Saving Private doesn't want to leave back home because he lost his three brothers, and they want to bring him back out of some publicity thing. So Matt Damon's like, no, I'm going to stay here with my brothers and defend this bridge, because if they lose the bridge, the Nazis are going to contain a stronghold, and they're not going to be able to advance into Berlin. So they stay, and they have this all-out climax war, and just everyone's just getting shot up and dying, and it's just like, it just seems very hopeless. Like, they're all trying to fight, and, you know, Tom Hanks is trying to storm the bridge because they've lost all their numbers, and hundreds of Nazis are coming over, and he gets shot down. He's trying to blow up the bridge to keep him from going. And, like, the end of the movie, he's just, like, pulls out this pistol, and he's just, like, shooting at this tank, and you're just like, really? Like, there's no way. How are they going to win this? And then in the last moment, the Allies come in, they sweep in with their planes and take out the rest of the Nazis. But the interesting thing about that story is, in that little situation and their little part of the story, on the big scale they were winning the war, but in that little scale it just seemed very hopeless. But they pushed on because they understood that they had a secure place to win the war. The climax was over. The hard part was done. Well, I want to talk about the falling action of the book of Romans, and that is chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. And so that was what I would consider the falling action, the direct result, what follows the climax of the story. And the climax I would put in Romans is probably Romans chapter 3 and Romans chapter 8. The crucifixion and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the work of Christ on the cross to appease the wrath of God and to save us from our sins. That is what I would consider the climax of the story. And so now we're in Romans 12, verse 1. And Paul says, because of what has happened, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So I bring up the analogy of the falling action with the climax because it's important that we understand that everything that happens in the falling action is a result of that climax, right? So he says, I appeal to you, therefore, because of Christ's work, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. So the falling action in this verse, so I'm going to take the structure of the climax, the falling action, and the result, and apply this to the couple statements in Romans chapter 12, okay? So what I would say is the falling action of this part of the verse is to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. That is what we should do because of Christ's work, because of his love for us, it is only natural that we should present our bodies as a living sacrifice. A couple things and notes about like the key words in here, the bodies. Why would Paul use the word bodies in this sense? It kind of means like a physical sense, like your outer body, right? Well, what he's saying is our actions, our external actions, what you use with your body, how you relate to other people, right? Eating, helping others, whatever it be, that you would do it as a living sacrifice, that it should affect the way you act, right? It should affect your heart, and then affect your mind, and then affect your hands, or the actions that you perform. Then Paul goes on and says, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. Well, back in Paul's day, a sacrifice was something that was dead, right? You killed an animal, and then you sacrificed it to God. Well, the Romans at the time had their own pantheon of gods, right? Jupiter, Zeus, and all those other weird names and stuff. And they would sacrifice on that altar, and that would be the one-time deal, and they get to appease God's wrath or something like that. But Paul is talking about a living sacrifice, a continual sacrifice. Just like the soldiers in Saving Private Ryan, they had to continually lay down their lives day in and day out until rather they won the war or they lost their lives for the cause. So Paul is saying this is a continual thing. This is something that you have to commit to ongoing. But how do we do this? This is something I really want to touch upon tonight because I think it's easy to hear these commands and just think on what we need to do. We don't think about how it comes about. But I want to talk about the climax or the catalyst that provides us to actually do those things, right? We talk about catalyst. I mean, that's the name of this whole meeting, right? It's catalyst to help you guys propel to do things for God, to be a living sacrifice. So the catalyst in verse 1 would be by the mercies of God. This refers to the work of Christ and his compassion and love for us seen in Romans chapter 3, the crucifixion and Jesus receiving God's wrath on our behalf. That is what it means to be by the mercies of God. And the result is our spiritual worship. Unlike the sacrifices of back then, we are not like sheep without sense who get slaughtered, but instead we willingly sacrifice ourselves because we understand God's character and love toward us. It is a volitional sacrifice. Worship is more than just Sunday morning. It's what you do on a continual basis in your life. That's what worship is. It's only natural, Paul is saying, that because of what Christ has done for us, because of his love for us, we should naturally be a living sacrifice for him in a response of love. So that's kind of the overarching statement of Romans chapter 12 right there, and starting in verse 1. Verse 2, he breaks it down more. Because the heart affects the mind, which affects the hands, Paul's going to say, well, it starts in the mind. So he says in verse 2, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Our mind affects our actions. So the negative statement is do not be conformed to this world. It means to not adopt the mindsets of this world. Do not become drunk with the ideas of this world that do not match up with reality. I just love that wording of like sober-mindedness, not being drunk with the ideas of this world. Where we're at, especially at S&T and in this world, there's different, like John Eldridge would say, scripts that the world gives us to live by, right? So you guys are an engineer. Well, there's a script for that, right? Get a good job, make lots of money. There's your script, you know? And be super smart and let people know about it, right? That's the script that you guys are given, right? We're all given a type of script, right? For those interested in music or the arts and stuff, be the best, you know? Wow people, shock people. If you don't do that, you're worthless, right? Those are the scripts we do. And so Paul is saying, do not be conformed to that. Understand, have a right knowledge and understanding of what Christ has done for you. Don't be drowned out with the wrong reality. That's something that's very interesting about our minds. Sometimes we live according to a reality that is not true, right? And the only reality we know is the Word of God and what it tells us, right? There's no in-between. There's the philosophies and mindsets of the world, and there's the mindset and worldview of the Bible. There's no in-between. So we have to be sure that we understand that a lot. The positive statement is to be transformed. Transformation is required in order to be a living sacrifice. Our minds must be changed, meaning we must see things as they really are. We must see God in ourselves according to reality, seen and discovered in God's Word. Okay, I'm going to be honest. When I read this verse, when I first read it, I was kind of like, okay, be transformed. Like, how do you be transformed? You know, it kind of seems like a passive verb, right? Be transformed. Well, there's a catalyst for that as well. And Paul says, by the renewal of your mind. Renewal comes from the Holy Spirit given to us as seen back in Romans 8. The Holy Spirit renews our minds to see reality as it really is. But how does this exactly happen? I want to pull up two verses. I do not have this on YouVersion, but if you guys want to look them up. The first one is 1 Peter 1:13-16. It says this, "Therefore, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passion of your former ignorance, but as he who called you is holy, so also be holy in all your conduct, since it is written, 'Be holy, for I am holy.'" So once again, Peter in this one is reinstating that preparing your minds for action, that your action comes about when you're preparing your mind for it, when you have a right understanding. We act on what we know, right? So he says, "Therefore, prepare your minds for action and being sober-minded." Once again, don't be drunk with the world. But what's the catalyst for this? To set your hope fully on the grace that we brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And it's also when he says, "Do not be conformed to the passion of your former ignorance," it relates very closely to do not be conformed to this world. But interesting enough, it has to deal with knowledge or understanding. But knowledge and understanding of God is not just knowing about God, it's knowing who he is, experiencing his grace and his love for us. That's why Paul wrote 11 chapters of theological exposition. Not because, you know, he just wants to talk about theology, but because he wants to show you the love of God for you. That's the only thing that's going to catalyze or propel you to be a living sacrifice. It's that understanding of what he's done for you that compels us and creates that desire to love him back, right? So our hearts affects our minds, which then affects our actions. So how is our minds renewed according to this verse in order that we may live as a sacrifice? We prepare for action through our minds by being sober-minded and setting our hope on the effects of the climax of Jesus' work, the hope that we know that Christ has redeemed us from our sin. If you think about Saving Private Ryan, all the soldiers there, they only continued on their mission because they understood how much of a leverage they had after D-Day. They knew they were going to win the war. They were banking on the hope that they were going to secure Normandy, they were going to secure France, and they were eventually going to secure Germany, and that they were going to free this world from tyranny and oppression by the Nazis, right? They acted on what they knew. That's why it's very important to understand God's love for you when we think about application. Unless we understand God's love for us, we're not going to be able to be living sacrifices, right? Another verse, 2 Corinthians 3:17 through 18. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all, with unveiled faces, behold the glory of the Lord, and are being transformed in the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So what is the catalyst in this verse that tells us how we can be able to be a living sacrifice? He says this. He says, "And we all, with unveiled faces," meaning we're no longer drunk or sober, right? We're no longer clouded by what the world puts in front of us, the scripts they put in front of us. "We can behold the glory of the Lord." That, and he says that there's a connection there. When we behold the glory of the Lord, we are transformed. So to be transformed, we have to behold the glory of the Lord, right? Which sparks in us a desire, a longing to know who God is. And we're changed from one degree of glory to another. So this isn't just an instant thing. It's what we call sanctification, right? It happens over a long time, to be transformed over time. And what is the result? So we have the falling action, the catalyst that causes that falling action, and then the result. And Paul says, that we be testing you, you may discern what is the will of God. That's the goal, so that we can understand what's right and wrong and what we need to do in our own lives. The will of God, though, is not what the future is, but rather what he wants us to do that glorifies him. That's another thing I just wanted to clarify. Like, when he's talking about discerning the will of God, it's not knowing, like, oh, you know, who am I going to marry in the future? Or, like, you know, I want to know, like a magic eight ball or something that tells you what's going to happen. That's not what the will of God is. The will of God is to know how we should respond to him in love because of what he's done for us. Just a couple application for the verses 1 through 2. Who sacrifices himself for that which he does not love? Seeing and experiencing God's love in the gospel is the motivation and catalyst for sacrificing ourselves. Kind of like here in Catalyst, we come here to gain an understanding of who God is. When I mean understanding and knowledge, when Paul means knowledge and understanding, he's not talking about this vague sense of like, oh, you know, like, I know about God, you know. It's kind of like saying, like, I may know about Nathaniel, but I know Nathaniel. Like, he's a good friend of mine. We talk together. We work in the same office together, right? It's a difference. I can know about him, but knowing him is different. It means I have an intimate relationship with him. I know who he is. He knows who I am. And we have this friendship, right? It's the same with God. Paul's talking about the knowledge and sense that we know him in a personal relationship, that we've experienced God's grace. So when we look at Romans 1 through 11, that's for us. That's for what he's done for us. And thus, it's only natural that we should respond with love, right, for what he's done. Kind of like that whole idea, like, you know, I don't know some movies, but it comes to mind some old movie or something where someone lays down their life for someone else and they're indebted. Or like in Saving Private Ryan, when everyone was trying to help Matt Damon, right? They were trying to save him. Like, the whole mission was to save Private Ryan. And at the end, you know, they save him, and Matt Damon is now indebted to Tom Hanks, right? He's like, this man saved my life. All these, like almost their whole band of brothers something died. And he realized that he was indebted to them, right? Because of what they did for him. And so he responded in a gracious way of having his life mean something. That's the kind of same thing with God. When he lays his life down for you, it's natural to respond in love, right? Like if Garrett came over and pushed me outside from a bus and like he got hit, and then I was just like, I hate you, Garrett. Like, I don't know why you jumped in front of a bus for me, but I think you suck. Like, that's not the right response, right? It's not natural. It sounds against our nature because it is. That's why it's so terrible to reject God, because of what he's done for us. So Paul is not saying be a sacrifice just to be a sacrifice. He's like, do you see God's love? Like, when you understand and realize it, it's going to affect the way you live. Transformation of self begins in the heart when we experience God's grace and love. Experiencing his love affects us. Transformation of ourselves. That goes to verses 3-8. That naturally will lead into transformation in community. So usually if you think about the building blocks of society, you have the individual, that is then the family, then the community or church, the city, the state, and the nation, right? So the only way that we can affect the family, community, city, state, or nation is by beginning with ourselves, right? Kind of like the Michael Jackson song, like, I'm looking at the man in the mirror, the one that's been oversung too many times. But there is kind of a truth in the sense that it begins with ourselves. Transformation of community comes from transformation in ourselves. And that's kind of interesting how Paul puts this in logical order, you know? It begins with ourselves. The catalyst for Christ's work propels us to be living sacrifices, and living sacrifices will affect the church and the community to be healthy, thriving sinners. So starting in verse 3, Paul says, for by grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. Understand that verse 3 is a condition if we understand verses 1 through 2, right? When we begin to understand not to think more highly than ourselves, that's when we begin to see God's grace, right? If I know that I've just been saved just as much as Christian or Nathaniel or Daniel, I'm not going to think myself more highly than you guys, because I've just been saved by grace just as much as you have. And the gifts I have to give other people and to use it is because of Christ, not because of my own works or because of my own abilities, right? Everything is because of the grace. Even Paul says, for by grace given to me, I'm exhorting you right now. It's not my own power. I'm not exhorting you because I'm just so awesome, but by grace given to me, I am saying to you not to think of yourself more highly, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. In verse 4-5, for as in one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. We have to exist as a community of believers, and there's no such thing as a lone ranger Christianity. We all need each other due to the different gifts that we have. The reality is that we are all one body, and because of the grace of Jesus Christ, it should only be the natural response to love others and use the gifts given to us. And Paul writes down a list of gifts. He says, having gifts that differ according to the grace given us, let us use them. If prophecy, in proportion to our faith. If service, in our serving. The one who teaches, in his teaching. The one who exhorts, in his exhortation. The one who contributes, in generosity. The one who leads, with zeal. The one who does acts of mercy, with cheerfulness. If you have those gifts, Paul is saying you need to use them. One, rather, you need the gift from someone else, right? That's why nobody has a monopoly on the gifts. Like, I know our staff did entire, who's got, I don't know, spiritual gifts or something like that. And, you know, most of us had teaching as one. But Mo had, like, compassion, right? And I don't know what I had, discernment or something like that. But, something. But, like, and Mo had exhortation or something. But if I looked at Mo and said, you know, I don't need you, like, you know, you're just, you know, whatever. You know, how would that be? I need her because she does have the stronger gift of compassion and exhortation, while mine's more teaching or discernment, perhaps. But see, God's trying to put us in a place where we're not prideful, right? Because all the gifts that he's given us is based on his grace, not according to my works or my ability. My ability to stand up here and preach and teach is not because I just, you know, am so great in rhetoric, you know, I'm like the next Socrates. That's not the case. I've been given grace to be able to bless you guys with the gift that God has given me. That's the only reason why I'm up here. That's the only reason why you guys are able to serve in the church just as much. The catalyst for our gifts comes from the Holy Spirit, who through grace blesses the entire church with these gifts for us to use externally. We are only able to perform by power of the Holy Spirit. The idea of community has been united by the work of Christ and the work of the Holy Spirit, and not out of any human effort. The catalyst for transforming community is the transformation of the individual, which is catalyzed by the work of Jesus Christ. I know that was like a little bit of a mouthful there, but what I'm trying to show is that when it comes to application, when it comes to this part, this is Romans chapter 12 on, is a lot of application. It's looking at the different sections of our lives and seeing how do we apply what we've learned in Romans 1 through 11. And so what I'm trying to help you guys understand is that heart affects mind, which affects actions. And it's really popular in the church nowadays just to focus on the actions, just to focus on the Ten Commandments and what not to do, what to do. But the fact of the matter is, we've already been given that. Back in Exodus, we got the Ten Commandments, but we sinned anyway, right? We had knowledge of the law. We knew what was right or wrong, but the problem was that we did not desire what was right. And that's why the work of Christ is so important, why the Holy Spirit is renewing us and sanctifying us day by day. We need the Holy Spirit to change us. When we understand the will of God through the transformation of our minds, we know how to use our gifts in the transformation of our community and the church. The individual is changed, and thus the community is changed. Christianity, like we said, is not a Lone Ranger thing, meaning your transformation doesn't just stop with you. It continues on with the church all around you guys. It's like in CCF right here. You're being transformed not just for yourself, but for the brothers and sisters around you to be able to help them, because we are part of the church. We are part of the universal church, and it's up to us to try to work together and to help each other renew our minds, right? That's the whole point, that we can come to a knowledge and understanding of God's grace. Grace transforms us. Knowing, understanding, and recognizing God's grace changes our minds and how we see God. It doesn't just tell us what is right and wrong. The love of Christ ignites a response of love to him. It transforms us to love him, and it transforms us to love the church. That is the effect, the falling action of Christ's work in climax. It is only natural that I should love God and love you guys because of what he's done for me, right? Kind of like the parable of the unforgiving servant. You guys all know the story where this one tenant, I don't know the fancy names of the people back then, but one guy owed another guy a lot of money, right? This king or something. And so he went to him and he begged him. He's like, I just don't have the funds. I can't do it. And the king was like, you know what? I'll forgive you. I'll forgive you of your $10,000 debt or something like that. And then right after that, the guy goes and finds someone under him who owes him like, I don't know, a grand or something, $100. And he goes to him and he's like shaking him, choking him. Like the Bible says, he's like choking the guy. And he's like, give me my money. I want my $100 now. And so the guy's like, I can't, please, you know, give me a chance. Like I don't have it. And so they take him, they throw him in jail. And then the king above the other guy figures this out. And he's like, hold on. Like I forgave you of like $10,000 and you're going to get this guy for $100. Like obviously you don't understand my love for you. And so he threw him into jail. And, you know, Jesus says it's kind of like the kingdom of heaven in the sense of, like, did that person really understand, like, the graciousness of that one king that forgave him that debt? And the guy probably asked him, like, I just don't know. I just really want that money. Like, I can't live like a sacrifice. I can't sacrifice my money to help this guy out. Like, I just don't know how to do it. And the problem was he just didn't look at himself and see the grace of Christ in his own life. So the question is, do you have any desire, longing, or thirst to respond as a living sacrifice for Jesus Christ? Do any of these commands make sense to you? When you look at, like, sacrifice, it's not fun, right? It's kind of like, that sounds really, you know, like the soldiers in Saving Private Ryan probably didn't have a lot of fun, right? I mean, having to give up their lives. I mean, if you watch the movie, you're just like, you want to be, like, millions and millions of miles away from what's going on out there. But the question I want to ask you guys is how do you do it, right? How do you obey Christ? How do you respond in obedience? And the solution is that if you don't perhaps have any of those desires and longings, maybe you need to look back and learn more about the love and grace of Jesus Christ. There's a reason why Paul wrote Romans 1 through 11, right? You guys ever watched the Ben-Hur movie? I know I'm making a lot of movie references, I'm sorry. Yeah, so Ben-Hur is basically, I'm not gonna go through the whole story, but basically there's this, these Romans are talking, and it's back after doing like Jesus' birth and stuff, and Christianity is beginning to rise more and more and more, following this guy. And the Romans are kind of getting fed up with this whole new Jesus Messiah figure thing. And one guy's like, you know, I mean, as the Roman army, we can defeat other armies. We can defeat powerful kingdoms and stuff. But how do you defeat an idea? And the bad guy in the main story, Masala, he's like, it's simple. To defeat another idea, defeat an idea, you need another idea to defeat it. So maybe you desire sin more than you want to be a sacrifice, right? Sacrificing your sin is maybe a little hard for you, and you're kind of like, I just don't have that. I just don't want to do that. Like, I don't want to live that way. That's your desire. The only thing that's going to take over that desire is something equal or greater that you desire more. But how do you learn to desire God? Simple. You get to know who he is. You get to know his power and his love and his grace. And maybe you're just like, I just don't feel that. Get down on your knees tonight. Get down on your knees every day and ask that God would reveal himself to you, that you would be able to behold his glory, that you wouldn't have this veiled face over you and you wouldn't be able to see who he is. Because if you're dealing with sin and you're struggling, a list of to-dos and not to-dos is not going to help you obey and be a living sacrifice, right? It's like the guy who is addicted to gambling and they thought, oh, we'll just take him away from Las Vegas and put him out in the middle of some shack in the woods. Did you fix the problem? Well, if he ends up right next to a casino, he's just going to go back to gambling. But if you put him back at a casino and he doesn't desire it anymore, that shows you true victory, right? I didn't want to give you guys just a list of 10 commandments or application points and not provide you with the catalyst that you need to be able to accomplish that. Because being a Christian is more than just simply doing things, right? It's holistic. It affects your heart. It affects your mind. It affects the very actions that you perform. That is the whole goal and point of Christianity. Not that we would experience freedom in knowing who Jesus Christ is. That he would be the prize of our lives. Not, I don't know what other prize. Anything that's worthless or whatever, you know. I always think about the parable of treasure in the field. Let's put a different spin on it. Let's look at it this way. Let's say the guy went to the field, found the treasure, looked inside the treasure box. You know, I think it's a treasure box. I don't know what it was back then. And he looks into it, and he sees some, like, notes or bills or whatever, and he says to himself, this looks like trash. Like, I ain't going to buy this field. I was going to sell everything I have and buy this field, but I'm just going to put it back in there and forget about it. And he goes off on his way, and come to find out it was the greatest treasure there ever was. But because he didn't take the time to really see the value of that treasure, he went away. When you come to Jesus Christ, don't just move away and just be like, I just don't think it's worth it. He's very valuable. That's what you need, that desire, that understanding, that knowledge of who God truly is in your life and to others. Romans 1 through 11 is for you. It's for what he's done for you. So that way we can experience the freedom of sacrificing our sins and enjoying God more and more. And that will transform you and will transform your community, and hopefully it can transform the world. It will transform the world. The climax has been done, and the falling action is the inevitable result. We have won the war. Sin can be conquered, and we can live as a unified church together. So if you need something to catalyze you into being obedient to Christ, look to his grace and experience in it. Let's pray. Lord, I just want to thank you for your word and the knowledge and wisdom you've given us to know who you are, God. I just ask that all of us would be able to behold your glory more and more, Lord, from one degree to another, that we'd be transformed by the love that you have for us. Lord, if we're struggling with seeing it, I just ask that you would spark in us a desire. Help us, Lord, to see it. Cover our unveiled faces, Lord. Help us to not be drunk, Lord. Help us to be sober-minded so that way we can see you, behold who you are, and glorify you. And that we can be living sacrifices, obedient to you. That it would transform ourselves and transform our community. I ask that you be with all the students and all of us tonight. That you would help us to think over these things, Lord. That it would catalyze us to read more of your word, to experience more of who you are, and that would affect everything we do, Lord, in heart, mind, and our actions. And I pray this in your precious son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.